Welcome to the Diablo 3 Open Q&A panel. Here to answer your questions are Matthew Berger, Wyatt Cheng, John Height, Brian Kindergan, Christian Lickner, Kevin Martins, Josh Mascara, and Jason Regier.
Is this on? Hey, how are you guys doing? Awesome. So this is the Reaper Soul Q&A panel. We're going to do a little something different for this one. We're going to ask you guys all the questions. So are we okay with that? All right. Awesome. All right. So as you see, we have quite a few of us here. We have our tech director. We have our art director, our production director, our lead game designer, our senior level designer for console, and we have Wai Chang, who will tell you more about his favorite class in a minute. But all right, let's get right into the questions.
Earlier on the room, it said that some of them are account boundable. Does that mean you're not going to be able to trade them, or just things that you're playing will drop? And then the second question is it just coming out for PlayStation 4?
On the account binding stuff, so Josh was saying earlier at a couple of the panels, and we've been saying in interviews all day as well, that I think that when we had the auction house live and when it's down, that trading was a valid way to get items, but the scale had gotten way out of whack, so that trading became the easiest, fastest, best way to get items as far as an efficiency point of view goes. So we wanted to rebalance that essentially. As such, we still do see the value of trading, and we want there to be a good social aspect to trading. So we're trying to keep the rules as wide as possible. Quite likely, and this could change by the time we ship, by the way, so by all means, come on the forums and express your opinion on this item. Probably the very top tier of items, maybe just the top tier of legendaries, will remain account bound. And probably commodities as well. We probably want to avoid having another Stone of Jordan situation where we get an alternate economy going because we didn't think this through. So we're working on all of this stuff, and it's still being locked down. So by all means, express your opinion on that.
Hola. When you get the PS4, well, Berger, I'm always stealing from him. But anyway, so PS4's question, I'll answer it real quickly since he snuck two in there. Early on this year, we came out with support for PlayStation 4. We want to make sure that we follow through with that here at BlizzCon and show you Reaper of Souls running on PS4. Future announcements are going to be in the future, but today it's all about PS4 on the console.
I can do one better than that. We are committed to taking your PS3 saves to PS4.
So he wasn't supposed to say that.
We are committed to that.
A little bit to your left.
Yeah, I saw the Loot 2.0 information in the previous panel, and a lot of the items look really awesome. Do you guys have any plans for expanding the stash space so we can store all these items?
Come on, Josh.
Apparently I have to take this one. At this point, no. Straight up, we're not intending to increase the stash space. We're approaching the problem from a different point of view. We're trying to find more things to do with the items you have, and less requirement or less need that you should feel to hold on to a lot of stuff. So there's a few different things we're doing for that. One of the main ones is enchanting and blacksmithing. So breaking items down, salvaging them is worth more. And if you have something that's almost good enough, of course, you can use enchanting to make it better. If you have a transitional item, let's say you found a level 40 legendary, you've hit level 50 and found something you want to replace it with, that breaks down and you can get one last hurrah out of that item by using the legendary salvage reagent to make your new legendary better. So that's just one example. We're trying to do a lot of stuff to make sure that you don't feel you need to hold on to a whole bunch of transitional gear. Many other things with Loot 2.0 is you're just getting better, smarter drops on a more frequent basis. That requirement, whatever it is that you're trying to hold on to, you just don't need to do it as much. So we're trying to make better use of the space you have, and we think that that's actually a much better, more fun solution than giving you more stuff that you need to manage.
Thank you.
So the less is more philosophy is really good, but we still need crafting materials. How do you plan on reconciling the two, and will we ever be able to do anything with whites and grays?
Currently, we're in our internal build. The white items do salvage into some basic crafting material. We're kind of looking at crafting as a whole. One of the changes that we're making is the in the live game, you have your normal crafting reagents, Nightmare, Hell, and Inferno at the different tiers. It's a little bit awkward because you'll enter Hell, and all of a sudden, all these crafting materials that you have become useless. So we're actually unifying that across the board. So from 1 to 60, you'll use the same single tier of crafting reagents. We want reagents to matter. We want you to be able to salvage those things, but we don't want it to become like a huge bookkeeping chore.
I think that's actually completely new information, isn't it?
Have we said that before?
Maybe. I think we've said it before.
Okay. Well, keep asking good questions. We'll see how much more we can slip up with.
Hey, this is a bit of a lore question. I missed the lore panel. A few years ago, I was at BlizzCon, and I asked about the Sisterhood of the Sightless Eye, and I can't remember who replied, but he said that they were definitely going to be part of the game in some aspect. And when I played Diablo 3, it was not there at all from what I could see. Can you give me an update about what happened or if they're going to be coming back in some way or touched upon?
I would love to give you an update. I just didn't hear, though, the specific thing you said you asked about.
Oh, I was asking if they were going to talk about what happened to the Sisterhood of the Sightless Eye, specifically, you know, how the rogues doing after their cathedral got all blown up by Andario and stuff like that.
I'm really sorry. I just still didn't hear the word.
What happened to the rogue?
Oh, the Sisterhood.
The Sisterhood of the Sightless Eye. Sorry.
Oh, of the Sight. Yeah. There was, during development of Diablo 3, I think there were a lot of plans, you know, a lot of things that people tried, you know, we explored putting certain things in, and sometimes it just became too much information or there was no good place for it. So, you know, obviously things change in development quite a bit. But I think that the Book of Tyrael and the Book of Cain both would explain a little more about what is going on with them, and a lot of other factions and such.
Thank you. Hi, guys. Just want to give a shout out to WackZack on Twitch. And my question is, I noticed on the floor there's some new monster affixes, like Poison Enchanted and I think Frozen Spike. Do you plan on expanding on that concept a lot more? Because it's pretty boring right now, to be honest, with the current affixes that are in live. So I just wanted to know if you had anything new planned there.
The monster affixes, the goal is to combine the abilities that the monsters have with a random affix pool. We are adding a few new ones in Reaper of Souls. But on that topic, we're also looking at the monsters that exist and making sure that their abilities are really shining through. Because it's kind of a balance, right? You have every monster who exhibits their personality and their unique abilities. And then the idea is that you layer on top of it these random affixes, and we want both sets to feel as rich as possible because, you know, at the heart of Diablo is randomness, and one aspect is the combat and the challenge that the monsters present. So it's a system that we're, you know, always working on, and you'll see some more in Reaper.
Thanks, guys.
How far along are you in Reaper of Souls? I know that you probably don't want to answer.
We're as far as what you see out there.
that's very revealing.
I will say that, you know, certainly we understand, you know, you guys want content, you want it, you know, probably at a more regular basis than we've given it to you in the past. We did spend a lot of time giving you 8 updates to the base game, and that has necessarily led to some delays in getting Reaper Souls out, but we're fully committed to getting stuff to you quickly, but we also want it to be the highest quality that we can make it.
And secondly, do you guys see more classes and, dare I say it, maybe a second expansion down the road? I know you don't want to answer that one either.
Oh, no, I think we have an answer. Maybe.
Nice.
Hey guys, I just want to say thanks for making such an awesome game. I've been a longtime fan of the Barbarian class, and one of my...
Yeah.
Sons of Bulkathos. One of my favorite things from D2 was finding a really awesome two-handed weapon and putting it in one. Are we bringing that back?
Well, I mean, the Crusader does have a passive that allows him to hold a two-handed weapon, you know, in one hand and a shield in the other. So, I mean, you can definitely do that.
You notice the Crusader's not a barb, right?
Thank you.
I know.
Woo!
Okay, thank you.
But it's still Wyatt's favorite class, right?
Totally.
Hello, I have two questions from some people on Reddit. One is, will you have ladder-exclusive drop items? And the second will you provide beta keys for those who pre-order?
So, I mean, we're not talking about ladder. We haven't announced any ladder systems. What we do know is that there's a desire for something. I mean, D2 obviously had, you know, ladder-specific rune words and stuff like that. So if we were to look at a feature like that, we would look at, you know, what is most appealing about that type of gameplay and how can we design the best experience for that style of gameplay. As for keys.
What was the other question regarding pre-orders?
Beta keys.
Well, you have beta keys.
Oh, I see. Pre-order. Yeah, are we going to have betas available? Yeah, we haven't announced pre-orders yet or any special exclusives. Our marketing guy was just out here, and I threatened to bring him up on the stage to answer those kind of questions, and he's running the other way. So if you take off right now, he's the blonde guy. His name's John. But otherwise, you'll have to wait for the announcement. I'm sorry.
Hey, guys. I'm a big fan of the game, and I'm really happy that you guys are adding a clan support to Reaper of Souls. And I wanted to ask, is there going to be a full-on chat lobby like there was with Diablo 2 and Battle.net 1.0, or are we going to keep the WoW-like chat interface?
So partially, but not exactly what you're talking about. So there is a clan roster window, and we've shown some screenshots of that where you get to see the miniatures of people, and there's dedicated clan chat. We actually have made some major improvements to the chat interface, but we haven't gone back to the lobby system. It is something that we've discussed before, and I think that it does give a nice sense of community to it. So between the clans and the group's features and the chat improvements, we're going to see how this goes over the next few months and try to build on what we have. And I think that it is definitely getting a lot better. So when you guys do get a chance to try that out, please send your feedback. We are reading it on the forums. Anything that you're putting in there about those systems specifically, I'll be reading, and we go over that actually once a week. So.
Hi, I actually had two quick questions. The first one was, I may or may not have read some data mined information about a game mode called Devil's Hand. I was wondering if you could even hint or elaborate on that, because it actually sounded like a really, really cool idea.
No. It's cool, though.
I will take that as a good hint. Secondly, the banners for the virtual goodie, really? You couldn't give us like some wings or something a little cooler than the banner? Just saying.
Ouch.
I like the banner.
Actually, Kevin loves the banner, so it's Kevin's fault.
Yay, banner.
They're awesome.
Hi there, guys. I just had a couple quick questions about like some of the builds. There's more like popular that are viable, like the Barbarian Into the Fray and Berserker, Thrive the Chaos, and the Wizard Critical Mass and Archon. Are those going to be changing in Reaper of Souls? And also, is lifesteal going to be, you know, because it's almost a must to have. I'm in hardcore, and I know in softcore, but you need it to survive. Is there any going to be balancing on that aspect?
Yeah, I'll answer the second question first. We do see lifesteal as an issue. It's not even so much the power level that it gives a player, but what it does for your perception of itemization as a whole. We have three stats that are on items for comparison purposes: your damage, your healing, and your toughness. And it's really a shame that players are, you know, hyper-focused on a single number of those three, only damage. And that's because lifesteal acts as a translation. It provides your healing and your toughness just by making your damage number higher. So it really distorts, you know, how you evaluate and look at your items. So lifesteal is not really good from that point of view, and we are looking to actually genuinely allow you to make conscious decisions about whether you want to have more toughness or more healing or more damage. And I think removing lifesteal allows us and players to do that. And regarding builds, you know, in Reaper we've talked about loot 2.0, and I think one of the general philosophies that's amazing about it is that the legendaries open up new ways to play the game. So I don't really see builds as being just a collection of skills anymore and then items as being a bunch of numbers. We're really looking forward to the idea that your legendaries plus your skills work together to make a build, and that a particular way to play is unlocked by you getting that sweet new legendary.
Hi, my question is regarding Templars. First of all, love the class. I've been playing the demo like crazy, and awesome class. Mostly about balancing, though. I felt like I was almost like a glass cannon. I was dying very quickly, but annihilating everything. Particularly, I can't remember the name of the ability, but it's the second one you can play on the number four ability. It does 1,500% weapon damage in a like consecration effect on the ground, and I killed Asmodan in like 4 seconds. So again, felt like a glass cannon. Is
what
that
took
the
you
intent?
So long?
Yeah, exactly. Was that your intent? Is that something that's going to be changed? What do you guys think?
There's a few simple things going on there that explains that. So we tend to overemphasize the combat abilities, like the direct damage abilities, when we put a demo build together, just because those tend to be more showy than the defensive stuff. And the other one is you're just not quite familiar enough with the defensive stuff. And then finally, the third one is, yes, we are still doing a lot of tuning. In that case, it's not a Crusader-specific issue. We have some generalized health and damage numbers, which do have class-by-class effects on them. And so probably both the Crusader needs to be tuned and the game damage at that normal difficulty level. And that happens all the time, once a week probably. Wyatt, we're tuning those numbers.
Oh, at least.
Yeah, until after release, right? Like, when everyone hits it, we keep on tuning for a little while, too.
And thank you guys for everything. The game is awesome.
Thank you.
Thanks.
How's it going? Excellent work on the job, on the game. I have a question about, I like the direction you guys are going with, like, 5 levels deep. I want to see something more like an endless dungeon and every 10 levels, you enter a room with like 2 butchers or something crazy where you have to further progress. And then if you die, that's it. You have to start all the way from 1 and go down to 150, whatever. Something like that.
So that request has definitely come up before within the team and without the team. So I basically call that a bottomless dungeon because I differentiate it from endless dungeon because we look at the Nephilim Rifts feature as an endless dungeon. It's not one dungeon, but it's an endless combination of all of the elements that we have with randomized monsters, levels, weather, etc. Some of it hand-touched, some of it completely random. So that is sort of an endless dungeon mode. I know that's different than what you're saying. However, bottomless dungeon has come up. It's not something that we're working on right now, but it is an idea that we like, so hopefully in the future we can do something like that.
Anything to do with death and like in softcore, if you like stay alive for like an hour, congratulations, here's a small buff, anything like that?
Well, it's nothing we've worked out yet. We have talked about, so you can have a death penalty or you can have a stay alive bonus. Whenever possible, we prefer to give somebody a bonus for something as opposed to penalizing for them for something. You know, we have a death penalty that works well enough right now, but there's really no meaningful stay alive bonus outside of Nephilim Valor. So it is something that we do discuss. I don't think we have a solution yet, and we'll keep going working on it.
And to follow up on that, I think Wyatt and I have had a number of conversations about this very topic, and we came up with some ideas. But if you guys have any ideas, you know, pass them along. You know, we're definitely something we want to try to address.
Hello. I know Order of Light is coming out at the end of February, and I wonder if you guys know if there are going to be any further tie-in novels.
It's actually Storm of Light. But, no, that's okay. Well, you know, our creative development department is always looking at different ways to continue to tell more stories in the Diablo universe. So, right now, I think the novels are in kind of a good place, and so yeah, I definitely see I see more coming on the horizon.
Do you know if they're going to come out more than once every 2 years?
That depends. I think the way that we really approach it is not so much a release schedule or like a release cadence. It's more when we have a story that we feel like we really want to tell. You know, so early on in the development of Reaper of Souls, we realized that there was this entire story that took place between Diablo 3 and Reaper of Souls, you know, where Tyrael realizes that he's got a serious problem and he's got to solve it. And his solution to that problem is actually the beginning of Reaper of Souls. So, you know, that felt like a story that we could tell and that we wanted to tell. So I think whenever we find a story that we want to tell, then we start talking about, well, whenever we find a story that we want to tell that doesn't lend itself to being in a game, that's when we start talking about other media, you know, whether it's putting stories up on the web or graphic novels or novels.
Okay, thank you.
Hey guys, regarding Trivecta stats, there is a huge issue right now just because that's what everybody gears for. You want crit chance, crit damage, and attack speed. Is there anything that's going to be done to kind of steer away from that? Because I know Paragon 2.0, you can put points in those stats, but as far as gearing goes, what else can we look for besides those three just because that's what makes us the most efficient?
Right, absolutely. So there's a sort of a multi-pronged approach on Trifecta. I had mentioned before that it's really a shame that damage is the only thing that people really care about. Lifesteal is a contributor to that. By removing lifesteal, we're hoping that maybe some of the over-analysis on just maximizing your damage number will ease up a little bit. Things like you're increasing your toughness, your health will matter as well. In addition to that, we have the primary-secondary split, which we had talked about earlier today, but it allows you to get some bonuses like magic find or pickup radius, and it's not competing directly with those, you know, primary stats. But most importantly, we don't want to take away Trifecta. What we'd rather do is provide you with even more options. You know, if you can only have so many properties on an item, our goal is to actually say, you know what, instead of there just being three, what if it was, you know, seven or eight properties that you want, and now you're going to have to choose how you want to build your character. Cooldown reduction, resource cost reduction, elemental damage, bonus damage to a particular skill. All of these things will allow you to improve your character and give you more options than simply the Trifecta.
The bonus damage to a particular skill is proving to be a pretty deep well that we can go to for replayability as well. Like, I have frequently been changing my build just because of that. I start to find items to encourage me, you know, say, do seven-sided strike, for example, which I didn't currently have in my monk build. I find one or two items, and I still have them in my inventory. All of a sudden, I'm using that, and I'm starting to enchant other ones to up that skill as well. So that's an interesting one to watch for sure.
Hey, what's going on, guys? Currently, the elites and the uniques are pretty boring. It's basically another monster, except it's blue and a little bit bigger, or gold and a little bit bigger. Is there any changes going to be made about that? Because it gets pretty boring just saying, oh, there's an elite pack. It's blue, you know?
Yeah, we've actually, internally, we've done some changes to both champion and rare packs. Champions, mostly we've varied the number of guys you're going to be running into, so the packs aren't always going to be three blue dudes who are the same. For rares, what we've done is instead of having one big yellow dude and his three little friends who are yellow and they're the same, we're varying the numbers quite significantly, like from 2 to 5, even 7, I think, for the minions. And we're also changing the composition of the minions so that they are different creatures. Sometimes it'll be, you know, a skeleton summoner with 2 shield skeletons and 3 skeleton archers, or it could be a skeleton summoner with 5 burrowers, for instance. We're adding a lot of variety in the monsters that can accompany the boss monster in itself so that it feels every time like you're running into something cohesive and different and not just, hey, look, it's one dude and his mini-me's.
Thanks, guys. Woo!
Hey. So one of the major critiques for Diablo 3 was, your weapon became your single most important item simply because all of your damage is derived from like a high top end damage. Like, why was that deemed, you know, the superior system? Because I always found it backwards for a wizard to be carrying a giant two-handed hammer as opposed to like an orb of Tal Rashah. You know, are you carrying that same system over into Reaper of Souls, or are you just gonna keep it?
Yeah, we're pretty happy with it. I know that it's a series of design trade-offs. Nothing comes for free sometimes when those tough decisions. The wizard uses their, you know, weapon damage to power skills. I recognize that's a departure from the way Diablo 2 did things, but at the same time, Diablo 2 had a different problem, which is that you sometimes didn't care about your weapon at all. Or there are certain inventory slots, and you know, you could stack up magic find in every single slot because you didn't care about a lot of other stats. And so we had to make a trade-off, right? There's no easy answers. And we really felt that using weapon damage allowed everybody, all classes, to care about the stats on their items.
Thank you.
How's it going, fellas? Really like the work you did. I'm sure you're wondering why I called this meeting. I'll be brief. Question number one, demonic essences. Will they have any viability in Reaper of Souls? Will there be crafting plans above level 63 that will utilize demonic essences, or my friends who have saved 3,000 of them, should they just start crafting away? If you want to know my second question, so you can think of that one while you're answering the first one.
Well, I don't actually think we'll be able to answer that today for you. Sorry.
Okay, no problem. The second question is, critical mass is used in over 95% of all my friends' wizard builds for the obvious reason that it reduces cooldowns, and I know that you're going to have to do something about this passive. And after playing the demo, I love the direction that the game is going. But I'm curious, is the problem more with the passive or the way that it is used with a skill like, let's say, Frost Nova?
I think the problem is it might be with the passive itself. I think that it's aggravated by extremely high proc scalers on a number of wizard skills. I think that we want to be looking at the proc scaler side. I think we want to be looking at the passive itself. I think we want to make sure that the wizard has viable alternative passives that are exciting to use. Frost Nova itself, I don't think, is a problem. So there's no plans to alter that. I think it's really fun to be able to CC an enemy. I think it feels powerful to perma-CC an enemy, but ultimately is bad for the long-term health of the game. So I think we want to be in a place, however we get there, where Frost Nova is still good, and I get a good long CC out of it when I use it, but I don't think we want to be in a place where I can perma-stun enemies all the time.
Thank you very much.
Hey, everyone. I have my own question, plus I've got a question here on the forum that I want to relay over to you guys as well. For the first part is, right now, Ubers are part of the quote-unquote endgame content you can explore, but you need to do them for the Hellfire Rings. Is there a place for something like this in the future with level 70 items and content?
Okay, so yes, there could be a place for something like that in the future, but we're not announcing anything about something new with Ubers today. So you had another question, though?
Okay, this one's from the forum, and it's mostly dealing with categorization. The first one is, why did you split the item properties into categories? The second one is, why did you split Paragon points into categories? And the third one is, what about elective mode, just like skill categories?
That's not more than one question, I think.
Categories.
Okay, so what was the first question again?
Okay, yeah, the first one is, why did you decide to split item properties into categories? And I like to add that, will this impact the Mystic rolling different things for those categories?
Okay, so yeah, so the reason why we did that is pretty straightforward. I think that there's some item properties that can just never match some of the trifecta or primary stat ones. It really doesn't matter how big your gold or health globe pickup radius is, it's never gonna be on the same thing. So if ever you have an item where you could choose between more intelligence for your wizard or that, it's always gonna lose out. But it's valuable to have secondary skills, nice to have skills like that. So we wanted them basically just not to compete with the main skills. So the main properties. So the properties that are the most competitive, the ones that give the item the majority of its power, they've been categorized so that they can be trade-offs against each other on a more equal playing field. And I think that gives valuable depth to it, and it should add some choice back in, especially with the addition of some of the new ones. So that's the reason why. And yes, with the Mystic, you can enchant the secondary or the primary properties.
Oh no, the enchanting as in, if you enchant the secondary property, is it possible to reroll a secondary property into a primary property?
No. A secondary property rerolls into other secondaries, primaries reroll into other primaries.
When you go to do the enchanting and you choose the property you want to, it shows you which category it's in and it shows you all the things that could potentially roll, so you're not going into it blind.
Out of time.
All right. Thank you. I wanted to tell you I love Diablo 3 and I'm looking forward to the Reaper of Souls. My question is about the Collector's Edition. If you do a collector's edition of Reaper of Souls, could you ensure that there are enough of them available that anyone who wants one can get one without having to go to a scalper?
We'll certainly take that under advisement. I think always the best thing is, you know, I hate to say it, but for fans to show their interest on the pre-sale side, because that gives us a strong indication, or at least retailers a strong indication of how many units. We don't actually determine how many units get manufactured. Retailers generally tell us, hey, here's how much we want based on the demand that we're seeing. So if you guys make a lot of noise, then we'll be happy to make more boxes.
Cool, thank you.
How you guys doing? My main question was the fact that people like ourselves who have actually been playing since Diablo 3 first came out, and we get up to MP10, are we going to be so overpowered that we're just going to raffle stomp through the expansion?
No. it's challenging, honestly, to have such wide variation in the item game where two level 60 characters or in the future two level 70 characters could have such an incredible disparity. But we like that as well. Like we don't want you to be able to simply max out, oh, I've got everything and I'm done now. You know, we don't want that to happen in any short period of time. If you enjoy playing the game, if you're still enjoying killing monsters, we still want you to have some sort of carrot that you're chasing after. So we don't want to stop that from happening, which would be the easiest solve. So we have, 60 to 70, there's some power inflation for sure. And it's not so much that it's out of control yet. And in addition, we will have more approaches to difficulty for people like that, where you know they can tune things to be a little more difficult for them. Essentially, it's probably not going to be monster power, but we probably give overgeared characters more ways to play as well and to tune that up more. So when you do get to that long end game and you've got a lot of Paragon levels or something, that you're still finding something that's challenging for yourself. So I don't know if I answered the question well, but.
First off, I ran into your wife, Brian, and she put me up to this. I apologize ahead of time, but
thank you.
I actually have a legitimate question regarding the art direction of angels as enemies. Now that we're seeing them as enemies in Reaper of Souls, I was wondering if you're going to deviate from the humanoid with wings aesthetic. I know lore-wise they're creatures of orders, but we might see something akin to like the weird configurations you'd find like the Old Testament, just in terms of art and lore.
No, I didn't catch that.
So we had a little trouble understanding, so I'm going to repeat it, and if I'm wrong, let me know. So regarding the art direction for angels as enemies in Reaper of Souls, we're sticking a lot with the humanoid, or at least as you've seen, and you're asking if we're going to go to some more crazy variations on angels?
Yeah, exactly. Like, you know, older legends describe them as like wheels made out of various animal body parts, or just something more along the lines of the variation we see with demons. You see so many different kinds of demons, but only one kind of angel.
Okay, so that's a good question, actually. So it's pretty challenging to design stuff like that, because what ends up happening oftentimes is that people have very specific views of what they think it should look like. And so we already have established looks for the angels from, you know, past games, obviously. So we sort of have to stick to that and make sure that we sort of use an evolution of that look, but make it interesting, but not go away from it. Now, when it comes to Malthael's agents and what they look like, from the lore point of view, I think we really wanted to tie him very much into the angelic side of it. We felt like that was going to be the really interesting sort of look for him. And so we used the idea of constructs that basically, they're not demonic necessarily, but they're these sort of things that he's created and turned into bastardizations of angels, so to speak. So we try to support that visually and sort of give that look to it, you know? So it's angelic armor with these sort of monstrous sort of looks. We just want to make sure that it didn't read like demon straight up, you know, like that would have been a little bit too easy, I think. So that was the goal behind that.
Yeah, actually, the angels closer to Malthael have become corrupted in different ways, and like Christian said, differentiating really carefully between angels and demons, even though the angels are doing something horrible to humanity, that doesn't put them in the exact same category as demons. They're still enemies. It's still a three-way system in there, so it's important that we keep the idea behind what corruption from demons looks like totally different from that of angels. So some of the angels you'll see in Pandemonium that we haven't actually shown yet, maybe you've seen glimpses of them in some of our gameplay videos, are starting to look more different than the angels you've seen thus far.
Thanks.
Sorry, it's slightly off topic, but maybe in the expansion you included as bonus content, I was wondering if you had plans to, or I guess, would you please consider releasing Diablo 1's original soundtrack?
I'm sorry, was the question, are we going to include Diablo 1 as bonus content?
That was just a suggestion of when to do it, but I was just asking if there are any plans to ever release Diablo 1.
You know, it's certainly something that we've talked about. We know there's a lot of nostalgia around those games. I don't know, my own personal experience is that oftentimes when we see those old games on, you know, new screens, new technology, high resolution, it sort of takes the blush off the rose, you know, so we always wonder, you know, if we were to put it out there and try to put it side by side with, you know, the majesty of something like D3, if it would really still hold that. So it isn't something that we completely would be against, but it is not something we plan on doing for Reaper.
I think he was asking about the soundtrack, right?
Oh, I'm totally sorry. I thought you were talking about including the game in there.
Oh, that was a good answer, though. But
I answered a completely different question, so you can sit down. Go ahead.
Right, but the soundtrack.
I can't answer the soundtrack one. You want to give that a shot?
I think it's a good idea. We should talk to people.
So. And actually, like I said, our marketing guy is hiding in the back there. So if he's planning content for, you know, collector's edition or whatever, that might be a good thing we could toss in.
Hey guys, just a quick question. Since you're limited by gear in D3, and MP10 was an awesome addition, using that same formula that you used, would you consider getting rid of the MP10 drop-down menu and just change it to a slider so you can go to, say, MP100 or whatever you want? Even though you'll get crushed in one hit, it's just for the challenge.
So, yeah, the MP system was something of a stopgap. I think it pretty did a pretty decent job for the, you know, for the goal that we had when we patched that in. We have discussed trying...
I think we're going to call it difficulty 2.0.
direction you guys are taking Reaper of Souls. I'm surprised no one has asked before, but is there any kind of update on PvP Arena? And what about a new follower with a new expansion?
All right, so PvP, you know, this is something that a week doesn't go by that somebody at the office doesn't come up and ask, what's up with PvP, Josh? You know, and this is something that obviously is something that we're interested in exploring. It's something you guys want to do. I think the real challenge for us is finding a PvP mode that really feels like it can do justice to what the core fantasy of Diablo is all about.
Microphone a little closer.
Almost. Sorry. Did you guys hear anything? Right, so we're really trying to find a way to express PvP in a way that does the core fantasy of Diablo justice. But one of the focuses on for us on Reaper is just focusing on the core elements, loot, the heroes, and I think we're off to a really interesting direction, and I think the future is going to be very interesting.
Okay, so what Josh just mentioned about focusing on the core actually applies to the followers as well. So we had a serious talk about adding a new follower early on in the development of the expansion. What we decided to do instead was we wanted to deepen the followers that we already have. Brian could probably give you a couple of examples of things we're doing for that right after this. So like he said, the core, we have three followers, and we feel like we did not do everything that we wanted to do with them, and some of the stuff we did do we felt we could improve on. So we took the same amount of development time and we put it into making them better instead. You want to give a couple examples?
Sure. The really big thing from a narrative and character standpoint that we're doing with the followers is in Diablo 3, you could go and talk to them in town and sort of hear their backstory and learn about, you know, where they came from and all of this, which was good, but it was still just a conversation. Now in Reaper of Souls, their story is going to continue to move forward. Each follower's story will still develop and evolve. So now it's not backstory, now it's happening real time. And you still talk to them quite a bit, but you're actually able to go on an adventure with your follower and help their story advance and help them develop as a character.
They'll also get a good tuning pass as well.
Thank you.
Hey guys, I was wondering if you guys have ever discussed the option of removing the strobe light effect when monsters take hits, because I feel like it takes away from the gothic feel and the fantastic monster art.
Want me to take that one? You know what? There's a lot of choices we make oftentimes that maybe aren't really real, quote unquote, right? I would say highlighting the monsters with the outlines, that's one of them, right? But I think when you're playing a game, we really try to focus on legibility, right? So a lot of the stuff we're doing as far as art goes, I'll give you an example. We use backgrounds that are a little softer. Your monsters and characters are a little bit harsher. They have a little different light, actually. We play a little bit of a trick there. Cast on them so that they pop from the background so you can read them easily. And I think the highlighting is a little bit of the same choice. Like, you want to see what kind of damage your stuff's making, right? You want the visual feedback of, hey, I'm hitting this guy, I'm hurting him, he's about to die, without having to look at the health bars or have them above the heads or stuff like that. So I think it takes away from reality a little bit, but hopefully it makes it a little bit easier to read and a better game as a result. It's a good point, though, and we struggle with that stuff because we're trying to find that sweet spot between what feels really dark and gothic and has a sort of nice Diablo feel to it. At the same time, though, make sure that everything reads really well and you're not getting frustrated because you can't click on it because you can't see it, or you don't know how much damage you're making because you have no visual feedback.
Cool. Thank you. So this question is for the min-maxers in all of us, I think. Across the board, Blizzard Games seems to have a lot of extensibility in add-ons and like the StarCraft map editor, the World of Warcraft add-ons in Lua, etc. And in Diablo especially, there's DPS, but your character sheet DPS doesn't line up with your effective DPS. So is there a way that there could be some in-game tools maybe added other than just percentages that would tell you you're going to do this much effective DPS without having to go kill a boss to figure out how long it takes to kill, et cetera?
So one of the difficulties for just, you know, the audience in general is there's always a conflict between maybe what we want to do as players and what we want to do as designers. And this is one of those areas where sometimes it's hard because I wish the focus wasn't so high on damage. You know, that's something that's been come up earlier today as well. Diablo's an action RPG, and it's I don't think the game's in a good state when everyone's hyper-focused on something like how much damage did I do? And if I'm in a four-player party, everyone wants to compare, you know, who did the most damage to the boss. I mean, I think that elements like who crowd controlled the boss or and froze it, or mobility, or having an interesting build, or amplifying the damage that my party mates do to it. Like, there's so many elements that I would like to have matter more than just my damage. So I think that when we look at the game, like, we're focused more on a variety of like combat experiences and combat pacing and making sure that I'm playing strategically, and that I really, you know, wouldn't want to provide even more tools that cause people to become even more hyper-focused on maximizing a number.
Hi there, I've got a question for the UI. I play in iFinity, and I first of all appreciate that you guys are willing to allow that. And one of the shortcomings is that whenever I open my inventory or character windows, they are way over here and over here, and I have to actually turn my head to look at them. And I was wondering if you have plans to potentially allow me to have the UI get constrained to the center monitor, or let me move my mini map, or expand it so that I can have it open on my right monitor bigger. I'd love some customization in the UI.
Well, I'm really glad that you're playing it on that monitor and that it works so well for you. I think that's really great. But right now we don't have any plans to customize the UI. Sorry.
Constrain it? Nothing?
You just wanted a little?
Just let it reflect.
Just a little moved in? Yeah, sorry, we don't have any plans for it. I'm sorry.
Oh, come on, can't you code that up tonight? Come on, he asked nicely.
He was really nice. I'm sorry. It's something that we will consider for down the road, though. There are other people like you, though. Thank you.
Hey, guys. My question is sort of related to all the questions you fielded regarding the trifecta. Right now, every class has a talent or a skill that allows you to convert your critical chance into resources, like extra spirit when you crit with one of the generators for the monk. So I'm wondering, is you gonna do anything to try to split those? Because right now, when I see something like the Frostburns in the screenshot earlier with no crit, I think, oh, I'm gonna be limited with my resource generation. And I'm wondering if those talents are gonna stay or go away or what?
It's like you were saying, it's the over focus on trifecta. You know, I don't think our job is to, or our responsibility is to make crit worse. That's our job is to give you more things that you might want to do instead. So I think that we should be looking at passives or rune options that make cooldown reduction, you know, even better. I mean, what a great place we would be if you're like, oh man, you know, I don't think I want crit on this item because I'd rather have resource cost reduction and cooldown reduction because that's way better for my build given the legendary that I just got. So no plans to directly hit crit, you know, head on.
Okay, thank you.
Hey guys, thanks a lot for all you do. I really appreciate it. Man, that light is bright. I play NVIDIA 3D on my BenQ monitor, and when I was playing it, I was like, wow, when I was in Chaldeum, the particles are right in my face. I absolutely loved it. I don't know if that's something you guys directly did, but going to the PS4, will you guys implement a 3D capabilities in that? I think it would be really cool.
Matthew?
Jason?
He's a... How about Matt? Jason?
That's a pretty good suggestion. We haven't planned anything like that for the PS4, but I think that's a pretty cool idea. I mean, we're always trying to make the game look better on PS4 because it's got so much horsepower there. So thanks for that great suggestion.
If you hear very carefully, you can hear the lead engineer on console, who is somewhere in the hall, dying as we speak.
Thanks, guys.
Hopefully, you said you played the PS4 version, but hopefully, if all of you, if you haven't given it a shot, you should take a look at it. It really looks beautiful. We're at 1080p, and it's pretty glassy frame rate on it, and this is just the beginning.
Hey, my question is about PvP. I played World of Warcraft professionally, and I've spent thousands of hours on Diablo 3, almost all of that on hardcore. I was really excited about Diablo 3, and I have loved the game, but I was disappointed when PvP got thrown on the back burner. I understand that it's very challenging to create like a meaningful like mode for that for Diablo. My question is whether or not you have ever considered incorporating PvE elements to a PvP mode in order to make it feel better, so it's not, you know, all about the balance between the classes, but there's this tussle between, you know, how you're fighting the monster, you know, racing to fight this monster at the same time as other people, but you can fight them to stop them from doing it, et cetera, et cetera.
I think, you know what, I answered the question the first time. I was trying to figure out how to express the fantasy of Diablo in the PvP setting. And I think that element of adding PvE elements, I think there's something there. And you know, when we have discussions, you know, some and ideas along those lines come up. And I think that, you know, as we keep thinking about it, as we keep sort of brainstorming, I think that's part of the solution. It's somewhere in that space. Maybe it's not PvP, but maybe it's PvEVP or something like that. But again, it's just, you know, right now we're just focusing on what's in front of us, and hopefully at some point in the future we can have an announcement.
So today during your gameplay system panel, you were talking about the right click and drag thing with the mouse, and I was wondering how that would work on the PS4.
Do you mean the specific Crusader skill?
Yeah.
Well, I heard that, but I also heard it about like other moves, I think, where like it was important to use the mouse, but the PS4 doesn't have one.
Okay, so if I remember correctly, we had a specific skill where the power was coming down from heaven, and we showed three iterations of it. The first two were ones that required mouse movements, and both of those we actually got rid of because we didn't feel that they controlled very well. So the final version of the skill, actually, we've given the effect its own AI, so you just fire it off as a Crusader, and it goes ahead and starts attacking monsters for you. It almost becomes like a mini holy hand of God fire thing from the heavens that works like a pet. So we probably won't have that issue, unless you meant something else, but I think that might be what you're referring to.
There are certain skills, definitely you're right, there are certain skills that require a little bit more precision, you know, like, for instance, a falling sword, Barbarian's Leap ability, where you're able to target specifically exactly where you want to go. It's more of a challenge on the console side, I think, and we tend to err more on making sure that the game feels very responsive, very kinetic, very dynamic, even if you use a little bit of precision. So you're probably going to see solutions similar to what we did with Leap, where if you just tap the button, it's going to jump where you've targeted, on the monster you've targeted. If you press and hold, it'll jump the full distance. Is not an ideal solution, and we're still looking at and maybe finding something better, but you're probably going to see something in that regards because it keeps the game dynamic and fast-paced, which is more important to us than having, you know, pinpoint accuracy in the same way that it is on PC.
Hello. You announced that the weapons that are going to be dropping are going to have elemental effects. And in current Diablo 3, only cold has a specific effect where it slows. Can you give us more specifics as to what a poison enchanted or a arcane enchanted weapon is going to do?
Want to do it? I can.
We haven't worked that out yet, so leave that for today, I guess.
Hi, guys.
I was a big fan of D2 and being a necromancer that could summon 15 skeletons and just wreck everything. And with glyphs and D3 with witch doctors, I feel sort of limited in what I can summon and do. And I wondered if you've considered maybe being able to get experience through your glyphs or your spells in order to increase the amount of creatures you can summon or missiles that you can project.
So basically, can we have a lot more pets for the witch doctor? Is that basically what you're asking?
Not just the witch doctor. Missiles for wizards or sorceresses, excuse me, or anybody that has any form of missile or pets or anything that can grow your damage.
Right. Okay. So keep in mind that the damage is organized around the amount of stuff that you can have on screen right now. So just, you know, doubling or tripling that, I think, can be done most effectively through Uber skills like the new Demon Hunter skill, where basically every type of ranged attack is coming off of her at the same time. That's one way we might do something like that. But the approach that we're taking from the ground up, or that you mentioned, like the Necromancer, where he just has 15 skeletons, we have fewer pets, and we recognize that the pets that we have for the Witch Doctor weren't doing the equivalent damage of necessarily 15 skeletons. And there's different ways to make them better. They are getting an overall tuning pass so that pets can be effective at endgame and higher difficulties. Many people are leaving them off their build because the pets, they're just not worth it, right? So we're trying to fix that aspect of it. And partly it's sometimes a technical issue as well, where we want to do fewer better things, and more isn't necessarily better. More can just mean more screen noise. We'd rather you have a few less but more powerful pets on your Witch Doctor, or, you know, number of missiles in the air, so you can see where you are, you can see where your effects are going, and then we can fill the screen with more enemies instead. So let's give you more things to kill, even if there's less of you. And I like that approach, and I do think that there was something cool about the Necromancer filling half the screen with his own little mini army. We've lost that a little bit. We had the fetishes, and it's not quite the same as the skeletons and golems. But we've gained something instead, which means you can put more of other stuff on the screen, most notably more expensive, better-looking effects, and way more enemies. Nephilim Rifts in particular, if you've watched any of the videos that we showed of that at the preview panel, you can see that on YouTube, I'm sure, at this point. There's some crazy high-density stuff in there. You know, you can have 5 minutes where the screen is just packed with skeletons and zombies. You can barely move. It's very interesting, without that legendary boots to let you move through monsters. It's very interesting to try to use your skills in a very different way in a room like that. The more players or player pets you put on screen, the less we can do something like that. So, like Wyatt mentioned, there's so many trade-offs in game design, and I think that we're about to give you some very interesting density challenges. And that's one of the advantages of doing it the way that we approached it.
All right, thank you.
Hey guys, how do you feel about high-level rune or high-level gems dropping, like Radiant Star Emeralds and things like that? Because you're probably sick of hearing about D2, but when a Zod rune dropped, it was like that month's memorable moment. So, like, if a Radiant Star Emerald dropped, that's a pretty cool thing too.
Yeah, we're that's something that we talk about. There's some changes that we're gonna have to evaluate, you know, exactly what we want to do, particularly with the removal of the auction house. I think that the way that the gems were experienced by the player is really changed in the presence of an auction house. If you play through the game self-found, you're actually happy to combine a few gems, and you ever actually never reach, you know, Radiant Stars or Marquees. So we're definitely looking at what does the removal of the auction house allow us to do, or should we do, in the wake of that for gems.
We have one more super quick question.
All right. Okay, my question is, with Diablo, it's very linear storyline. With you guys wanting to put more random with all the adventure modes and stuff, is there any idea of making the event quests have consequences to them if you do them or not? Like, if you do one, somebody might turn evil that will show up and kill you, and if you don't do it, he might go out and not give you a sword or something like that that you want. It feels like I don't have control over if I want to do an event or if it has any consequence.
So and putting consequences on them, like tying a random event into stuff that's happening elsewhere in the world, we definitely have tried that long before Reaper of Souls and Diablo 3 development. And it works. It's fun in the way that you describe, but it causes one problem in that it removes a potential for randomness in the other situation as well. So when we have, like, it makes your game more complex, and it makes you have less randomness elsewhere. So if you did one thing, maybe even a little bit unintentionally, you just ran an event, and you're taking something else away otherwise, and it slows down our rules and our ability to roll more random worlds. So we've decided to try to keep things more self-contained. You see this all throughout Diablo, long before Reaper of Souls. Most of those events are self-contained because we can do so much more with the game after that. And we do lose that sort of tied-in subplot connection to the world thing when we do that, but it gets us a game that moves much faster and allows you to leave whenever you want and come back when you want and still get things rolled. We don't have to start saving like 20 different choices you made in that game and therefore having 20 fewer random things that happen next time you enter the game. So we chose the randomness over that connection.
But there is, I mentioned before about going on an adventure with your followers. So in that particular case, if you don't go on that adventure with them, then their story doesn't progress. So there is at least a consequence to your choice there, right? And we do have a couple of events in part of the game that are actually sequential, in the sense that if you're playing and the first of this particular set of events rolls and you do it, then you have the chance to do the second event, which builds on the first, not immediately, but whenever that second event would roll. And so if you don't do that first event when it rolls, then you know the next time you play, you're back in the pool of having that chance of that first event to roll again.
All right, guys, I think we may be out of time, so I just want to thank you for all the great questions, and thank you for coming to BlizzCon and checking out Reaper of Souls. Thank you.
Up next, Epic Cosplay and You panel. Welcome to the Epic Cosplay and You panel, hosted by Epic Cosplayers, including Blizzard's very own Jessica Johnson and Christina Sims.
There, BlizzCon. Let us. So, how many of you guys are cosplayers? Oh, nice. Happy to have you here.
We are very, very excited to bring you our first ever Epic Cosplay New panel. And we're going to talk shop with some of BlizzCon's most talented cosplayers that have graced our stages.
Absolutely. We are incredibly excited to bring you our guest panelists. We've got Lorraine Torres. Come on, Lorraine. We have Avery Faith. Woohoo! Laura Jansen. And then last night's winner, Svetlana Quint. Woohoo!
Thank you guys so much for joining us today. I'll let you get settled. All right. I think we're set, so we're going to kick it off. First off, welcome to Epic Cosplay and You.
We would like to show the slide. Excellent. So our hosts, those of us, we've got Christina Sims, most well known for her monk cosplay, but she's also an integral part of our Hearthstone community team.
And to my left is Jessica Johnson. She is part of our cinematics team and has done a pretty accurate StarCraft Ghost.
Thank you. And then if you don't recognize our panelists, we're just going to give you a nice introduction of like what they're most well known for.
Lorraine is most known for winning our BlizzCon 2009 contest with the Mistress of Pain. Avery Faith was our BlizzCon 2011 winner with the Adjutant. Laura Jansen was the creator of the Epic Gamescom winner, the male barbarian from Diablo 3. And you all are familiar with the winner of the contest from yesterday, Svetlana Quint. All right, so we are going to dive right into it. But first off, what is cosplay?
Yeah, and what makes cosplay different than the costumes you're going to wear during Halloween?
Lorraine, why don't you tell us a little bit about what exactly is cosplay?
Cosplay for me is it's basically my way of expressing my love and gratitude towards, you know, the games and, you know, that I'm really interested in. And what better way to do it than to dress up as a character? And really bring those characters that you get to see and play in the games to life. So that's what it is to me.
Avery, what about you? What is cosplay to you?
Kind of the same thing. Like, I'll watch movies like Lord of the Rings and be like, doesn't it suck that you'll never see like an actual orc in real life? Like, I really want to experience this stuff. So my point with my cosplay is to make the stuff look like it stepped out of the screen into real life. Like, what would this character wear if they were real? And it gives me an opportunity to take on like another persona. And it's a way to change who you are and explore different realms of things that you're really passionate about.
Laura, you've created some fantastic costumes. What kind of things inspire you to make cosplay?
I really love to bring the characters to life. I really love it to create it because I have so much characters especially from computer games I love, and it's so fun to bring them to life and to walk on a convention and be this character. This means very, very much to me.
Awesome. And inspiration can come from a wide variety of sources, whether it's video games, whether it's anime. Svetlana, what kind of things inspire you to create a character? What do you look for in a character when you're making a costume?
For me, it's much more, my dreams. I mean, when I'm really creative, I'm not able to start with a costume when I still didn't dream about it. So for me, it's cosplay really bringing my dreams come true. And it's video games are really inspiring, but I think cosplay is especially, bring fantasy to life.
Awesome. So when we're going back to our slides here, cosplay inspires everybody a little bit differently, whether you're taking a character from a game that you love and wanting to bring it to life. It's really all about expressing your passion through art.
Oh, absolutely.
And being able to show it off to the world and being able to show it off at venues like BlizzCon is an amazing experience for all cosplayers.
Absolutely. And just having the opportunity to show it to like a crowd of people that are just as jazzed about those games and those concepts is really, it's really special. And special to see that in real life, too.
So now that we've got an idea of what exactly is cosplay, and at the root of cosplay actually means costume play. So we dress up, we have fun, and at the root of everything, we're having a good time. So now that we know what is cosplay, let's talk a little bit about how do you guys make this stuff? How do you guys take something that's so intricate in artwork and bring it to life in a three-dimensional sense? And this can be very, very difficult because things that are existing in fantasy artwork don't necessarily translate well to real life.
Well, that's true. Gravity has no like concept in concept art. And actually, this is really useful for all of you guys in the audience. We really wanted you to walk away with new knowledge, or at least new ideas of how to approach costumes in your own time. And who better to learn it from than award-winning cosplayers? Lorraine, can you tell us about some of the crafting materials that you use a lot, but also just what household items you've found that were extremely useful and you didn't expect?
To make any cosplay, you can use basically any materials you have at hand. I have come to a point where I'm using materials like Warbla and Wonderflex, which are both thermal plastic materials. You heat them up, and they'll take the shape that you want. They'll adhere to themselves. I use that kind of material to make something such as a headdress, like you see here. Even details that you find on the headdress and even other parts of my costume are made using this heatable plastic. You've used fabrics. You've used anything you can for piping, the little gold accents. Household items, Sharpies, X-Acto knives, I mean, you name it. A necklace that you may have decided not to use ever again can be part of a costume.
It's really that versatility that really separates cosplayers, because if you take something as boring as cardboard and you can make it into something out of this world, it takes a lot of time and it takes a lot of talent. Now let's take a look at these pictures here. Lorraine, what is happening in that left picture?
So we have the headdress in early stages. You see the white part there is used basically for, you got the, I'm sorry, you have the craft foam and you have the Wonderflex sandwiched. So it'll be Wonderflex, craft foam, Wonderflex, and the idea is to create strength to support such a big, structure. I later upholstered it with using the spray adhesive. You can get that at craft stores, and fabric, of course, to get the look that I was after. Basically, after that, it's step-by-step layering of all the materials that I kind of mentioned before.
So in the right picture as well, you could see a crazy-looking boot and as well as a half-destroyed house with cosplay. What percentage of your house is destroyed when you create a costume?
I'd like to say 100% of my house is destroyed. My boyfriend can attest to that.
It can be a very, very messy process.
Oh, yes. Yeah, and it's not just relegated to the garage, it's every part of your house.
Yeah. So in the second picture, Lorraine, you've got a couple other things going on. Is this the evolution of the Izan hat?
That is correct. This is, again, the hat, and you see my heat gun there. It's the yellow, crazy-looking contraption. That thing is great. Be careful. It is really hot.
So things like heat guns, they're used to actually heat things like Warbla and Wonderflex to get them to soften up so you can form them into anything, right?
That is correct.
What other things in your Izan costume did you use Warbla and Wonderflex with?
Virtually anything. I used it mainly for the hardware components, anything that's gold and it looks fairly solid, like all that is Warbla, basically.
Very cool. So moving on to Avery. Avery, we've got some of your crafting materials here, and there's a lot of bottles that may not be very clear to the audience. Can you explain, starting from left to right, what kind of things go into your cosplay?
Yeah, on the left we have a variety of acrylic paints, and actually there's an enamel paint there, which is a really, really great base paint. Like Lorraine was saying, you do things in levels, so you start off with something that you might not think would look good for a piece, like these pieces started off with that black enamel paint to give it a nice base, and then when I brushed the gold that's in the middle, I'm sorry, the gunmetal gray that's in the middle there, it was a little translucent, so you get a bit of the black showing through, and it makes a really nice kind of like a, you know, like hewn metal look. And then you add the light colors for detail, for highlighting, and then some stain in the, carving and runes and that to give it a little bit of depth. And it really just completely changes the look of it. It makes it look real and tangible. Then we have the sealer, which is super important because it's so terrible to do a great job on a paint job and then be like applying your highlighting and rubbing it and it all comes off. So I seal between every single layer. In the middle, I have a little tiny bottle there of Tester's metal paint, which is great for if you're painting any kind of paint or like want to change hardware. I'm fanatic about details, so like even on my Garona boots, the original hardware on them was gold, so I went and hand painted every single little thing with the silver so it matched. In the middle, I have a molding paste, which I used on the adjutant because it was my first time working with Wonderflex, and it was terrible and lumpy and looked awful. And I put on the molding paste, and it really filled it out and gave it a really nice finish that I didn't have to sand or anything. And then that's Hobby Light underneath it, which is for repairing little tiny dents or cracks or anything like that. You rub it in, it basically turns into like almost like a balsa wood, and then you can sand it out. And then next to that is Gesso, which is a canvas primer for artists, but it makes a really great cover for any kind of, for Wonderflex, Warbla, any kind of foam. But it's really rough. It's almost chalky, so you have to put on a lot of layers of it and sand it out. It's a lot of effort, but you can create beautiful, smooth looks. And it's a good alternative to Bondo that isn't as chemical and doesn't require as much work. And then on the right is my absolute favorite glue, E6000. That's a spray version of it, but there's also a gel version, and there is a craft version, which is quick drying, but it's much more liquid, almost like a crazy glue. And that stuff's amazing. The gel and the spray stuff take about 24 hours to set, so it is something you want to do like beforehand. It's not like a repair thing, but the hold is unbelievable. And then the front, I've got some Sculpey, which is great for making little details. Like if you want hardware that doesn't look like you went to Home Depot and bought a bunch of bolts, you can sculpt your own. I actually used a candy mold and then pushed the Sculpey in, and the candy molds just look like these little gems for all of the rivets and hardware on Garona's outfit. And then also some foam glue. It's really important to have a huge variety of glues because I ruined a very beautiful commission doing E6000 on foam, and I thought it would be beautiful to hold the pipe in the middle, and then I picked it up and it had eaten through the entire thing. So you really want to make sure that you have the right materials for the right the right stuff that you're working with. Same thing with paints and whatnot. It's awful to have a gorgeous finished paint job on something like this foam, and then you spray it with an aerosol sealer, and you just watch it going and falling apart in front of you.
One of the things about cosplay as well is when you're a casual cosplayer, you don't have access to things like labs or great factories where you can
crank out pieces of armor one after the other. Everything is really meticulously handcrafted, generally in your house or apartment.
Yeah, absolutely. And just being able to see craft foam like at a hobby store and be like, oh, I could turn that into armor pieces with the right amount of paint and glue and clay. And using the Sculpey clay actually to make your rivets is a really smart idea because it's much lighter weight than the metal pieces you'd find at a hardware store. But then also you get to, oh, I really wanted to find that one particular screw knot thing. And no, you actually just get to make exactly what you want. And Sculpey is a bakeable clay, so it ends up being really easy to use because once you bake it in the oven, it's solid and permanent. And you can paint on it and you can really put it in your costume and use it however you need.
Just one thing about cosplay is you always want to remember that some things do produce fumes and some things are innately unsafe, so don't keep your heat gun on and walk away.
Yeah.
And I'm sure we all have our battle scars from cosplay, whether it's a burn or maybe we've spray painted in the house for some crazy reason. Or is
that's
that
a little
that
lightheaded?
Just me?
Yeah. No, yeah, it's me too. Actually, reading the warning labels is super important.
Yeah. So always, always be safe when you're cosplaying. So, Laura,
yeah?
Move on here. I'm sorry, Avery, we've got some additional tools here. And these are things that you can pick up at like any of your local hardware stores. But let's start with the weird green thing on the left. What is that and how did you apply it to your cosplay?
That's a hot wire cutter, and that's really good for cutting foam to get really clean edges and stuff. It gets a little bit of a ripple and stuff because that's this old janky-looking machine, so there's actually much nicer ones. But I use that one particularly because of the inconsistency in its texture, because I wanted the beveled edges on my sword and my axe. The yellow on the right is a heat gun for any kind of Warbla Wonderflex. You can also use it on EVA foam and on craft foam are both heat sensitive as well, not quite to the level that Warbla and Wonderflex are, but you can shape a lot in mold to get your base shape and then shape your Wonderflex and Warbla over that. Under that is a Dremel, which I use for all the weathering and battle damage. And then under that is a soldering iron, which is good for LED stuff or for doing detail work, like the runes on the weapon. These in here were all cut out with the soldering gun.
And these things you can keep in, you know, your garage or your home, and they're relatively safe as long as you know how to use them.
Yeah, those all belong to my dad except for the heat gun. None of those are mine.
So with the actual raw materials, let's take a look at this slide. And there are a bunch of just rolls and weird colors. What are these things and how did you apply them to your cosplay?
On the left is a big roll of EVA foam. This is the stuff you find on like gym floors or like children's play mats. You can get it at Home Depot. I actually got a huge roll of that at Ross for like $15 and it was like yards and yards and yards of EVA foam, so it was a great buy. And that's great for making things like really intense armor that would be really big and heavy, but you don't want it to look heavy. Things like Halo Spartan stuff, Space Marines, they use tons of EVA foam for super big armor pieces. The one in the middle is Wonderflex, which actually you can buy it from a couple places. You can buy it online, but they parcel it out. I actually went to the local retailer in LA and started up a business account, and now I get it in bulk with a discount. And I did that, you know, 3 years ago when I didn't have any kind of credit to my name at all. So it doesn't really, you just have to go out and make the connections. In the front there, the pink and the white is pink insulation foam, which you can get at certain Home Depots, but it's kind of hard to find. I think it's a weird zoning thing. You can't get it in certain parts of LA and Orange County. And then PVC foam, which is great for, I'm sorry, PVC pipe, which is great for handles on things like this that are, you know, non-lethal and fairly light. And then on the right, on the very top, I have super easily accessible things. That's just craft foam like you'd get at Michael's or Joann's with some caulksaver from Home Depot. It's used for like filling in gaps in caulking or vents and that kind of thing. And then underneath it is all the stuff that you need to cast resin gems and stuff, which is much more expensive, obviously, than the things on the top, but just as easily accessible. You can go to Michael's or Joann's and get that. And it's resin, a catalyst, and a quick set silicone for making the molds. So you make a mold of something, or you pour the silicone around something that you'd like to have the shape of. You can make it yourself out of something like Sculpey or clay, or you can have a pre-existing emblem or something like that.
So these things, not only are they accessible, but they're actually rather inexpensive. So anybody who wants to get into cosplay can actually get these things at, you know, their local hardware store or craft store and get started. And the best thing about cosplay, and possibly one of the worst things, is trial and error. Sometimes you'll spend hours working on a particular piece and you're working really, really hard and maybe it doesn't work out, but you just want to try again.
Oh, absolutely. Or sometimes it doesn't turn out and then you keep working on it and working on it and somehow can transform it into something actually kind of useful. But yeah, because of the low cost threshold, a lot of people can get into doing really incredible cosplays on their first go.
So Laura, we've got some tools of your tools of the trade here, and a lot of them are similar, and you are also from Germany, so we might see a couple things that are a little different.
Yeah, these are all the tools I use usually for my cosplays. First, we have the big blue heat gun. This is my favorite tool because I use it very, very, very often because I work with thermoplastic materials like Warbler, and you need it to heat it up. So the heat gun is the most used tool, and especially we have scissors. You need scissors for everything, and a cutter, then a marker, or I always use a soldering iron for ornaments. When I burn something into EVA foam, you can burn ornaments in it, or for every electronic stuff, you can use it. And there we have, I think it's a screwdriver. Screwdriver? Yeah, okay, it's right. You can mold. I use them for molding when I make ornaments, just pushing them into the hot warbler. Or, what was the word for the
hole punch.
Hole punch. Okay, yeah. The hole punch when I work with leather and and this thing in the middle.
The rivet setter?
Rivet setter, yeah. Rivet setter and the hammer for all the rivets I put on my leather things. These are all tools. And especially the brushes for all my painting stuff. These tools I use for every costume.
Very cool. Yeah. You have a lot of paintbrushes, and I know I have a bag that just collects over time. Eventually, you just amass a...
Sacrificial paintbrushes, actually, for like when you're using glues or anything. Yeah, I've got a lot of those, too.
Yeah. Cosplay is not complete without a cosplay helper.
Yeah. I have my cosplay helper, my little cat. She's always by my side, and she always helps me. Sometimes she carries some stuff away.